The following is a Hoop Ball presentation.
Welcome to another edition of the Hoop Ball Sacramento Kings podcast on the Hoop Ball Radio Network. I just made that up. I am Christian Villere. You can find me on Twitter at my buddy Chris. For all of Hoop Ball Sacramento Kings coverage on Twitter, it's at Hoop Ball Kings. And for all of your NBA news, NBA fantasy news, and Sacramento Kings coverage period, it's hoop-ball.com. If you haven't gotten the fantasy draft guide already, please go to the website. Do that ASAP. On Tuesday, this upcoming, mark your calendars, Mr. John Schifferle and I will be doing a live show after the game against the Denver Nuggets in Denver. We will be doing that on Periscope. Keep your eyes peeled on the at Hoopball Kings Twitter account. It will be there for you to consume right after the game. Unfortunately, I probably won't be able to keep up with your tweets if you were to tweet at us, because there's only so much screen space on my laptop and my iPad is a little on the fritz at the moment. Once we get that up and going, that'll change. On the show today, we have John Schifferle. You can find him on Twitter at John Schifferle. He wrote an excellent piece that I have yet to read, but I have all the confidence in the world that it's excellent, on the big man defense that the Kings are displaying at the moment. Go to hoop-ball.com to consume that as soon as you can. All right. On the show today, we talk about a good many things, including the first three games that the Kings played against the Jazz, Pelicans, and the Thunder. A lot of stuff emanated from those games, and we hit on just about all of it. So enjoy this episode of the Hoop Ball Sacramento Kings podcast. He is back on the show. He has a new position. I don't know if he has a new title. We're going to figure that out right now. John, you're doing something different for hoop-ball.com. Tell us what's different and what you'll be doing this season.
Yeah, I mean, when you get to where I'm at, titles are just irrelevant, you know?
Oh, no. We're definitely going to come up with a title right here and now. That's very important.
I mean, okay, we can think of one. But it is true, I'll be doing something a little different. Instead of doing the pre- and post-games, I'll just be trying to go in-depth a couple times a week and just talking about generally what happened, a little bit like what we're doing on the podcast, but I guess in writing form and a little more video, and we'll see how that goes.
Actually, I guess it is the same title, because you're going to be covering the Kings.
I think so, yeah. Just same title, but, you know, more impressive stuff.
Okay. All right. Sacramento Kings beat blogger for Hoopball, Mr. John Schifferle, joining us today. Like usual, we have three Kings games to break down. The start of the season is here. Wednesday against the Jazz in Sacramento, Friday against the Pelicans in New Orleans, and Sunday, that is today, we're recording on a Sunday night, against the Thunder in Oklahoma City. The theme for me across all three of these games is the Kings getting significantly better from game one to game three. I think that has a lot to do with the fact that Jaeger futzed with the rotations today. He left De'Aaron Fox out there with the second unit. That played a big part in them being able to pick up this win today against the Thunder. Against the Pelicans, I thought they could have had a chance in that game. The Pelicans are good. You were right. I was wrong. He took out his first unit. He put in a full line change in the late third quarter of that game on Friday night. Did not do the Kings any good. The Pelicans took over from there. They were hot from beyond the arc. The Kings still can't stop anybody from the three-point line. It showed in that game. Today, they played a little bit better on defense. The Thunder were a little lackadaisical. There was a lot of turnovers. They were able to save themselves with a lot of second chance points. For me, the big takeaway from all three of these games is they improved significantly from game one to game three in terms of playing together on offense. And they played a little bit more cohesively on defense, although there's still a long way to go there. What do you say, John Schifferle?
Yeah, one of the big things for me in terms of, you mentioned the fact that he was willing to change the rotations, and that seems like a thing he's been willing to do in all three games so far. where he's just going to kind of go with who's ever hot. He's going to go, like we saw today, Shumpert played. I think they said to guard Paul George, but then they also said he wasn't guarding Paul George. So either way, they're willing to change the rotations based on who they're playing, who's hot, and just how they feel about their matchups. And with a bunch of really young athletic guys that are, you know, really playing with a high level of effort, there's not really anyone out there that's not playing really hard. I think that's just going to lead to some really good games. So I think they look really good through all three. The offense has been good, but the defense could use some work still.
You said the offense could use some work still?
No, the offense could definitely use some work, but offense overall has been much better than I think you could have expected through three games.
I like the offense through three games. I think a little bit of one-on-one play has hurt them on offense from time to time when they get into a crunch.
Yeah.
They will fall back on that. There was a period, I want to say it was late in the first half today against the Thunder, where the crowd was getting loud. The Thunder were on a run. They fell back into some one-on-one play. Willie Cauley-Stein forcing something, going to the basket that is just a little bit outside of what he's capable of right now. Outside of that, I thought they really played well on offense. And with De'Aaron Fox, we talked a lot about him coming into this season. I think he's established himself well and shown that he can definitely run this team. He said after the ball game when he was interviewed by Grant and Doug that the game has slowed down for him. And from what I can see, that looks to be the case. And he is certainly pressing the issue, knowing that he's got to play well for this team to win.
Yeah, I mean, just through these three games, I'm not sure that he had three games this good last season at any point, even if you want to cherry pick just his best three. I'm not sure he was this good at any point. So, he looks really good. And the offense, there are little things here and there I can certainly sort of complain about a little bit, but it's just so much better than what we saw last season and what you really could have expected from a team this young that's still trying to figure out who they are and who's kind of their alpha dog, who I think De'Aaron Fox has definitely established himself there. But there's not really any player on the roster I'm disappointed in at this point.
The only player that I think would mildly qualify is Justin Jackson. He's still in that sort of funk. He was playing a little bit better today. Going back to De'Aaron Fox, though, against the Jazz, when I watched that game, I thought to myself, he's really not playing that well. I didn't think he had that great of a game. I thought back on that game a couple days later, and I realized, somebody said on Twitter, he played really well against Rubio defensively. Rubio got completely shut down. He had a good line. I don't really put a lot of stock in that. But I think shooting numbers were good against the Jazz. The one thing that stuck out to me, and it's stuck out a little bit against the Pelicans as well, is his shot selection is still ho-hum for me. I would like to see a lot more at the basket, which he did more of today. But just get rid of the mid-range, because it's not an immense strength of his, and it's a low percentage shot. He's shooting a little bit more from beyond the arc. He made a really nice three today, which is good to see. More of that is really going to benefit him and benefit this Kings offense. The big men are actually playing well on offense as well, and Willie Cauley-Stein has been a surprise. What have you seen from him that you've liked?
He's really focused on being aggressive in the pick and roll and using his size around the rim. And I think he's playing within himself more. So he may be taking, in my estimation, less shots, at least, you know, per minute he's on the floor or whatever, less shots than he did last year. And the ones he seems to be taking out are the ones where he seemed to be forcing the issue. And you brought up a play. Honestly, I don't remember exactly how you described it, but when I think back to watching today, there was one in my mind where he drove from the perimeter, and it just seemed like a very classic Willie Cauley-Stein drive where he just didn't really have an idea of what he was doing. He was just hoping he was too athletic and too big for whoever was defending him.
Yeah.
But he's eliminated a lot of that from his game. He's playing a lot harder than I think I remember him playing. Grant and
Doug,
thank you. Grant and Doug were a little hard on him today, honestly, for his his inability to box out Steven Adams and lightened up as they realized no one could box out Steven Adams. But, yeah, he's been really good through three games and better than I would have expected.
He played really well against Anthony Davis, and when he went out of the game against the Pelicans, there was nobody to defend Anthony Davis because Costa's sitting over there on the bench with a hamstring injury. Against the Pelicans, the big men defense, you mentioned it a little bit with Adams today, it's going to be an issue because Bagley and Giles are in the beginning stages of learning what they need to do on the interior. It looks like it's a lot more serious than they expected, and that's hitting them kind of hard right now. Adams taking up the interior, taking whatever real estate he wants. Same thing against the Pelicans. Randall, Mirotić. And Mirotić and Bielica, that was fun on Friday night. The play where Mirotić got the and one early on, that was two brothers in the backyard. And one brother did not care that he was going to foul the other. Did not care whatsoever, but the other brother still made the basket. That was fun to see. Not fun was the fact that our guy was on the losing end of that battle because Mirotić absolutely owned Bielica. He owned the Kings in general. He's really good. The Pelicans are going to be good, like I touched on earlier. But just lots to like. Even with this team being 1-2, I could see the trend of them being better in Game 3 than they were in Game 1. It was by significant margin. This offense looks much more cohesive. It looked way more cohesive today than it did in long stretches of the game against the Jazz and against the Pelicans, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, if you look at the Jazz and the Pelicans, I think if you look at the Kings' big men, Willie, as big as he looks and as big as he can play, I think offensively, defensively, he still doesn't have that strength to match up with guys like Gobert and definitely not Anthony Davis. But I think they just really struggled with that size. And for a team with a center in Willie Cauley-Stein and then two first-year big men with Giles and Bagley that aren't necessarily particularly huge, I think you couldn't have drawn up a much more difficult three-game start for them with all three of those guys. So they've done really well with that. And I think that's going to be a weakness for them trying to match up with those really, really big front courts that I just don't think the Kings have the size to. Even with Kufis can help a little bit, but you take a lot off the court when you take off Giles, Bagley, and Cauley-Stein, because all three of them do contribute offensively, I think at this point, more than Kufis does.
Yeah, but I think Kufis defensively, it knows a lot more of how to guard and how to get his spot and keep somebody from knocking him off of his spot, which is useful.
Yeah.
And he could have, I think if he's in the game against the Jazz and against the Pelicans, I think the score is a little bit tighter. I don't think the game was tight against the Jazz, but I think definitely against the Pelicans, it's a little more tight. And that one hangs in the balance a little bit longer as opposed to getting blown wide open there late in the third quarter.
Yeah, and I think generally speaking, if you look at Willie, he's finally at a place where I'm sure that he's better than Kufis offensively every game, where I don't think I felt that way last season. And Bagley is going to have his struggles from time to time, but is clearly just really annoying to play against with how much energy he has. And trying to rebound against him is just insane with how much he's able to get back up immediately after going after it. And Giles has struggled with shot selection. I think you and I talked about that. But at the same time, he does have those moments. Like today, he had two really fantastic passes. And he loves to pass to people who are cutting. Mm-hmm. But he had some fantastic passes today. So I think, generally speaking, this is the first time where you can really say, since the Kings got Kufis, really, where you're absolutely taking something off the floor offensively, at least, when you're putting him on. And his defense may compensate for that, and it may be worth it in the long run. I think against the Pelicans, Giles was really struggling, so it would have absolutely been worth it to have Kufis out there. But there's going to be lots of games where it's just he helps you defensively, but is it worth what you're giving up offensively by taking off those three guys?
I think Giles and Bagley will acclimate defensively, at least in terms of banging with these big guys quicker than I think they'll do it pretty quick. I don't think the learning curve will be large, simply because these guys are basketball gym rats. They've been playing for a long time. They've got a great feel for the game. Yes, it will take a little bit of time, but I think they'll come around to it sooner than you might expect. I don't say this as a Homer Kings fan. I say this as somebody who's watched a lot of basketball, has a semi-decent sense for what those two guys are offensively and defensively. I could see them coming around to it like the next game. Is that shocking to you for me to say that at all?
I mean, not really. And I think the play that you can kind of see it in, and not that they'll be elite or anything like that, but you look at that play against Randall last night, or I guess Friday night at this point, where Bagley clearly doesn't really have the size to necessarily compete with Randall, but just how athletic he is and how much energy he has on the defensive end, he still bothered him too much, still bodied him up pretty well, and got a great block and then got the rebound. And you could tell that Randall was overwhelmed. And it wasn't necessarily size. It was just the full combination of everything that Bagley kind of brought to the table. So I think, yeah, they could improve really quickly. And it really has to do with the fact that they are a little bit athletically overwhelming, and they do just keep coming at you, and they don't want to be bad defensively. You can tell that it bothers them when they get beat on a cut or whatever, you know? So
there was something I want to move away from defense real quick, because we're talking about Giles and Bagley. I want to talk about something specifically with Giles for a second. Sure. I noticed I want to say it was all three games, where they were trying to set him up for alley-oops. He didn't get any of them, I don't think. He might have been able to guide one, but he had zero lift. I was shocked at how little lift he had off the ground. I would have thought he would have gotten at least one of those, but he didn't get any of them. The lift was bad. That was highly concerning for me.
He doesn't have lift when he's running to the rim, but he does have lift. Like, if he's just standing still, he does seem to have it. And it's one of those things where I remember at Duke, people thought his athleticism hadn't come back at all. And now a lot of people you see that are like college basketball analysts or whatever, and they're talking about what they're seeing from Giles. They do talk about how he's not athletically what he was, but he's a pretty impressive amount further along than he was at Duke. And so I do just wonder if he's getting his athleticism back in chunks. And if honestly, part of that also is, I don't know that I really want to go all out when I'm running to the rim like that either, if I'm at all concerned about, you know, just having knee injuries, which he's clearly had a lot considering how much he's played. And so I wouldn't be shocked if he's a little hesitant on those plays. But yeah, I saw one specifically today where it felt like he didn't really get off the ground at all.
I will say this in his defense. None of them were great setups.
No.
None of them were absolute slam dunk opportunities for him. And that might have played a part. He might not have been giving it his all. And I can definitely understand that, because he was not in a good position for just about any of those opportunities. Rotation. Yeah. Is there anything else you want to add on that?
Well, I guess on the flip side of that, as much as I thought Marvin Bagley was an incredible athlete, you know, 3 months ago when they drafted him, he gets up pretty unbelievably sometimes.
He is truly impressive.
Yeah. And I honestly can't think of a comparison for how well he gets his second jump up.
His ability to rebound and his nose for the ball are good signs for the Kings.
Yeah.
Especially for a team that has not rebounded well historically. It's good. The one thing I will say, though, he will go after offensive rebounds with a little too much chutzpah when he needs to be folding and going back on defense. Just let it go, bro. You ain't got it. It's time to throw in the cards, head back on defense. I know defense isn't your forte. That's why we need to get back there early and get to concentrating, because this pick and roll is about to come and it doesn't look good for you. Big man defense, something you hit on. We gotta what do you call it? We got to promote the spot. Not the promote the spot. What do you call it? What's a, not a cheap pop. It's a...
Honestly, I haven't heard either of those things. So.
No, the hit. We got to pump your article. You posted today.
Plug.
Thank goodness. We got to plug your article. Go to hoop-ball.com. John Schifferle dropped one of his long... Does it qualify as a long form piece?
It's long enough.
It's a long enough long form piece. He's developing his own literary, carving out his own literary niche, which long enough long form piece on big man defense. Spent a good amount of today working on that. Would you like to tell us at all what you were discussing in that article?
Yeah, it was mostly just about the fact that the Kings have really struggled to guard pick and rolls this whole season, and a lot of that just has to do with the fact that Willie Cauley-Stein hasn't been the best rim protector. Bagley and Giles are just getting lost a lot, and the game's still clearly slowing down for them defensively. And it seems to be a lot of what has led to them giving up. I want to say, I counted up, it was 272 points the first two games.
It's 123 and 149. Right?
Yeah.
It's a lot.
Yeah, it's a ton. And so I think really most of that has just been the fact, you know, you have a lot of plays where Bagley and Giles were getting lost when they were out there, especially against Anthony Davis. And then a lot of plays, Joe Ingles in particular, really carved up Willie Cauley-Stein in pick and rolls in that Utah game. And so there are some decent signs. I think Bagley has shown probably the most encouraging defense to this point just because he's so active on that end. But he's getting a little lost. Giles, I think, got completely lost in both games and looked a little better today against the Thunder. And Cauley-Stein is still – he's showing more effort, but I think he gets caught too often halfway in between staying on his man, which he had plenty of reason to do against Davis and Gobert, and the other half of that, going and actually protecting the rim where he kind of gets caught in the middle – doesn't go after the shot, and isn't really anywhere near who he's guarding. So that was the crux of it.
Well, I noticed today that Bagley tried to trap the ball handler, which did not end well. It ended in two dunks for Nerlens Noel. I'm pretty sure that's not how that's supposed to work.
Yeah, he in the first games, honestly, what I was seeing where he went and kind of trapped, but almost – just looked like he froze a little bit and ended up guarding the first person he looked at. And today I think he actually committed to trapping, which was a little better. But all of them really need to learn to actually go out and just show for a second and then recover. Or if you're going to trap, fully commit to it and try and get the turnover. Because the minute you leave someone, especially some of the more skilled bigs like Davis and Mirotić, if you're going to leave them and give them an open lane to the basket, it's over if they get the ball. So you better just make your whole goal making sure that whoever has the ball can't move it.
That is one way to do it. You could also roll with the big man and try to prevent the dunk or try to prevent the pass from being completed, right?
Yeah, well, that's where I'd say you just show up really quickly just to slow down whoever has the ball immediately and then recover as fast as you can. But the minute you've shown too long, or you've decided to, you know, fully come up against whoever is the ball and you've given up that room, it's over. So I'd say ideally you're just showing really quickly and then getting back to recover. But, you know, if it's been too long, just commit.
Agreed. Let's get to rotations because it's a hot topic, as always, with basketball period, but especially with Sacramento Kings and Sacramento Kings fans. I like the rotation today. There were some tiny little things that I might change. Buddy, I didn't see Buddy at all in the second quarter, I don't think. And Buddy wasn't really in it at all in crunch time. Justin Jackson was in instead, and Amon Shumpert was in instead. I would prefer to have Buddy in as opposed to either one of those two guys. Shumpert had it going today, so I guess Justin Jackson. And then there was something I wrote down here against the Jazz. Oh, shucks. I don't want to read through this while we're recording. And then on when Friday, I made mention of it earlier, where he just made a complete line change. He went back to Frank Mason at the end of the third quarter, along with a bunch of other guys, the young rookie bigs, and that preceded a downfall. I liked what he did today. He kept De'Aaron Fox out there. Grant and Doug made mention that De'Aaron Fox had 31 minutes, and it wasn't even the start of the fourth quarter yet. I know you don't want to put too many miles on a young guy too quickly, but if this team's going to do well, you're going to need to be playing your best players big minutes. That's, you know, as basketball goes, you're going to be needing to do that. Did you like what you saw out of the rotations today?
Yeah, I honestly, it's one of those things like the offense where there are little things here and there I could nitpick for sure. But overall, they're so much better than last year. And I think he's going with, again, the players that have the matchups and the players who have a hot hand. And I did think it was weird that Buddy only played like 22 minutes today, because I honestly thought he looked good. But
and he didn't. I didn't see any mistakes out of him. I didn't see any glaring issues that were really a problem at all.
I mean, one, maybe two things from him, but it's not like Justin Jackson was on fire or anything like that, where you'd bench him for someone. He should have played 30 minutes, I would say. But that's one of those things where it feels a little nitpicky, and overall I've been really happy with it, and maybe there was a reason, I don't know. But yeah, the rotations I think have been good. I think they're a little inconsistent, but they're inconsistent to the point that they should be for a team that's as deep as this team is.
I was also a little shocked today when he came out with Giles as the first big man sub for Willie Cauley-Stein instead of Bagley.
I have noticed that Willie Cauley-Stein offensively pretty typically is the guy that when he's in there, they're going to give him the ball in the high post and they're going to try and run something with like a handoff or have him find a cutter or whatever. And Giles is the other big that does that in reality. Bagley is not really asked to do that anymore. He kind of plays a little bit on the perimeter and then a little bit as like a post-up big. But Giles is the guy that replicates what Cauley-Stein is asked to do offensively. And I kind of wonder if that's the reason where when Willie Cauley-Stein went out, he figured Giles is a little bigger than Bagley, so he might be a better matchup for Steven Adams. And what we're losing Willie Cauley-Stein offensively can be replicated a little bit better with Giles.
You're saying that Giles can run the offense out of the high post like Willie Cauley-Stein can. Bagley cannot do that as of yet.
Either he can't do that, or that's just what Dave Yeager views Giles as, the Willie Cauley-Stein backup at this point.
I think Giles' passing, like you mentioned earlier, is quite impressive. The vision is very, very good. It's very saucy. I enjoy it quite a bit.
Yeah, and lots of confidence. And part of that really helps just because when he sees something that he thinks is open, he just goes for it with no hesitation, and I think that helps him a lot. And I mean, I guess generally speaking, he sees Bagley as the Bielitsa and Giles as the Willie Cauley-Stein, and I think he tries to keep it that way for the most part.
I also very much enjoy the fact that we're seeing Bielitsa as opposed to Randolph. And I'm not talking about that, like, this year he's going with Bielitsa as opposed to Randolph. I'm comparing this year with Bielitsa versus last year with Randolph. And the experience is so much better.
It's
so much more enjoyable. The games are so much more enjoyable. It's so much more enjoyable to watch cohesion on offense as opposed to possessions getting hijacked by 22-foot jump shots or 21-foot jump shots or whatever is a jump shot that is slightly less than a three-pointer.
Yeah, he honestly actually helps young players versus making it a problem for them. And I'm sure Randolph helps off the court. I'm not saying that he's like useless or anything, but I think Bielitsa is clearly a better fit offensively, and it has been more fun to watch.
You brought up to me before we hopped on here that you had some stuff you wanted to say, some general coaching points you wanted to bring up. What are those?
Oh, yeah. So one thing, I don't know if you agree with this or not. We'll see. But this team seems well coached to me. Do you feel that way?
I feel like I love watching Yeager's pressers because they're entertaining, number one, And he does say stuff against the Pelicans. He pretty much, he gave a 2-minute assessment of what happened that was glorious. You didn't need to watch the game. You could have watched his post-game presser, and he broke down the whole thing for you. I do think they are well coached. They more so today did, I think, what he was looking for on offense than they had in the previous two games, which is a very encouraging sign. But they do look prepared. Coming out of timeouts, they, of course, have amazing plays. Yeah, it feels good. It feels like there is positive momentum and positive cohesion between what he is telling them to do and what they're actually doing out there on the court.
Yeah, and everyone plays hard. Everyone seems to really buy into what they're doing and playing within the scheme. And honestly, everyone's scoring and everyone's kind of thriving in it. So they look like a team that they're buying into what they're being told. And offensively, at least, it's working.
Completely agree. Anything else on the coaching front that you wanted to bring up?
I guess it's just worth mentioning the defense. I don't blame the coaching on at this point. Just, I don't think they really have a rim protector, and I think that hurts them a lot. And the reality of developing Bagley and Giles in their first seasons together means you're going to see some bad defensive nights. Yeah. Just kind of how it's going to work.
Agreed. Something that I wanted to bring up that has nothing to do with basketball. I think Doug is doing really well. I think he is much better on color this year than he had been in previous years. You do not agree?
I agree, but there was something that really bothered me today. Did you hear what they were saying? Like, the first time I heard them mention it was when Fox was guarding Schroeder on a pick and roll, and he was pretty aggressive defensively, and they brought up that Schroeder shoots like 20-something percent from the field and 20-something percent from the three-point line this season, and so you don't have to just give him the shot or whatever. And it's like, do you know who Dennis Schroeder is? I get that he's shooting 20% over the last two games. That's great. But he's a real NBA player that's played for years. He is not a 20% shooter, and you do have to worry about him and giving him open shots.
I can see that. That's almost falls into over-preparation, but it also indication of the fact that he's not taking into account the rest of his career. He's only looking at a two-game sample. I see both sides, as I often do.
I mean, in the one sense, he's just a 5-year NBA vet. He maybe even 6 years at this point, and he scored like 16 a game or something last season. He's good at one thing, and it's scoring. And so it was almost like they didn't know who he was to me. But yeah, I do think he's doing well. That just bothered me because they mentioned it like three times after that too. But Grant was like, oh, yeah, you, as you mentioned, you don't have to worry about that shot. And it's like, you really do. I don't know what you guys are saying.
Have you looked at any kind of advanced analytic type stuff? You've been on NBA.com/stats or whatever. Have you looked at any of that early on to see if there's anything going on below the surface we're not aware of?
I mean, there's only a whole lot that you can take from it at this point. And I've looked at some. Most of it was just like direct matchups with, you know, you saw in that first quarter, for sure, you could see that Giles struggled a lot against Amon Shumpert. Giles struggled a lot against Anthony Davis. And I want to say he was like 4-for-4 against Giles in that game and just like 15 possessions, something along those lines. You could see Bagley struggled against Mirotić. Mirotić was like 6-of-9 against Bagley in that game. I'm mostly looking at matchup stuff, and to me, all I've seen is that the Kings are struggling with big man defense, and that's going to happen when you play really good bigs. It's also going to happen when you play two rookie bigs. So not a whole lot that I could take from the advanced stats other than those.
I think that's going to do it, actually. I thought we were going to run long, but I think we've pretty much said what needs to be said for this team with three games into the season. The takeaway for me is things look better than I thought they would, and that's encouraging for a team that I thought that was only going to win 25 games. They may only win 25 games still, but it's going to be an entertaining season. For sure, a lot of improvement. There's lots, and we still haven't even seen any of Bogdanovich yet. Bielitsa has been a surprise. He's playing well, even when he's not putting up. He probably didn't put up a big stat line today. I didn't look, but he was effective. He had to have a positive plus minus because he was just doing little, any tiny things. Like, he batted the ball off of somebody today when it was getting thrown down the court and got the Kings an extra possession. Little stuff like that to bend the win probability in your favor. I love that kind of stuff.
One thing I will say that you mentioned that Fox is taking some, like, less than favorable shots. I'll say they're a little bit better than last year. I've seen a lot of what you saw, like, in the Utah game. It seemed like he sort of lived off of taking tough shots and just making them. And I honestly think that's encouraging to me because his shot selection has gotten a little bit better. At the same time, he's hitting really tough shots. And to me, what that says for a guy that's scored essentially, I think, 20 a game so far is there's still a ton of growth there. And he's scoring 20 a game right now. He could be so much better if he took better shots. And he's showing, like, he looks like a player who's going to make those steps. And so I'm excited.
And I think they're going to give him the time this go around. I think Jaeger's finally going to get the chance. And I say Jaeger, but I think the coach is finally going to get the chance to see this thing through, see the players develop. I'm hopeful that an extension will come on down the line. I think that's going to be the case. At least that's what I would say three games in. I'm sure things will change before we get to the end of the season, but there's promise there. And that's, as Kings fans, with where we sit right now, I'd say that's about all that we can hope for at this point. Anything else you want to add before we sign it off?
No, that's all.
All right. Well, this has been the Hoopball Sacramento Kings podcast. You can find us on iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, YouTube, and of course the Hoopball radio app, which you can get for free in the iTunes or Google Play store. You can find John Schifferle on Twitter at John Schifferle. You can find me on Twitter at my buddy Chris. For all of Hoopball Sacramento Kings coverage on Twitter, it's at Hoopball Kings. And for all of your NBA news, NBA fantasy news, and Sacramento Kings coverage, period, it's hoop-ball.com. Go get the fantasy draft guide. I'm sure the leagues have already started, but what the heck? You can still get the draft guide. Keeps you up to speed on everything that's going on with the NBA in great depth. That's going to do it for us. Until next time, see you later.
This has been a HoopBall presentation.